discussing news and issues in orthopedics and spine healthcare. This is Spine Talk.
Hi, this is Dr. John Shim. I'm here with Jason Mazza, orthopedic assistant, talking about the long-term results of surgery versus non-surgery for a condition called lumbar degenerative spondylolisthesis. There was a recent study published in Spine about this very issue. Does surgery help? Does surgery not help for people who have spondylolisthesis in the older population? Jason, can you tell us about the study?
So, as you mentioned, this is published recently here in Spine in 2018. The data from the study actually goes back to the early 2000s from what we call the Spine Patient Outcomes Research Trial, or SPORT trial. This was a randomized trial consisting of 13 centers in the U.S. In which patients were randomized either into a group of non-operative care, which consisted of physical therapy and non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, versus a surgery group, which included decompression with or without fusion. And it was further studied different types of fusion techniques, including posterolateral with autologous bone versus pedicle screws versus a 360-degree fusion. There was also an observational cohort for those patients who declined to be randomized. So the authors of the study looked at the primary outcome measures of the SF-36 pain and physical function scales, along with a modified Westry disability scale from 6 weeks all the way out to 8 years post-treatment. There were 304 patients that were randomized and another 303 that fell into the observational cohort. From the data and the conclusions drawn, that 69% of those patients that were in the randomized group, they had complete data, and 57% the observational group had complete data at 8 years. The authors concluded that there was a significantly greater improvement in the surgery group versus the non-surgery group in all measures reviewed for the as-treated analysis. Fusion technique really had no effect on the outcome. In this study, there's a lot of data in this study. However, I kind of do struggle with some of the conclusions that were drawn and perhaps some of the methodology that was used. It is maybe somewhat not clear at first. So, Dr. Shim, I guess my first question to you before I kind of go through some of that is, what's your first impression of the author's conclusions here?
Well, as a surgeon, it actually gives me some comfort. I want to know, as a surgeon, if I do operations, people do get better, and it's better than non-surgical care. So I think every surgeon likes the conclusion. What gives me pause, though, is there's so many factors within this study, so I don't know how conclusive we really can be.
So a couple of the things that I wanted to point out here is, again, we talked about the title of the article relates to lumbar degenerative spondylolisthesis. When you kind of delve into the study and you look at some of the criteria, inclusion criteria, really and truly it's about spinal stenosis with spondylolisthesis. And the authors did a great job of quantifying the spinal stenosis, what levels, what degree. And again, the purpose of those that had surgery was to decompress. However, they really didn't get into putting much information here about the degree of spondylolisthesis. We really have no information on whether flexion extension x-rays were obtained for these patients, looking at the degree of slip, how much instability they may or may not have had. And again, that may or may not affect the outcomes. Perhaps the biggest kind of takeaway for me was that 44% of those patients were lost to follow-up. So it'd be very difficult in my mind to kind of ascertain any kind of long-term conclusions with losing that many people over the 8 years. And the authors themselves did note that those that were lost tend to be older, sicker, and had the worst surgical outcomes. So, Dr. Shim, for patients that you see that have this very condition, spinal stenosis with lumbar spondylolisthesis, and let's say they fail non-operative management, how do you determine whether they would benefit from a laminectomy versus that of a laminectomy infusion like the authors talk about in this?
Well, actually, if you go back to the study, not every patient who had surgery had a fusion. So this study was really about surgery versus non-surgical care. It is kind of interesting. When we're residents, we're in training, we're always taught that when you have a spondylolisthesis, that's a slippage of one bone on top of the other, you have a potential instability, and that instability needs to be fused. So you need to have a fusion operation to prevent motion and a better outcome. What this study demonstrated, at least from the standpoint of surgical techniques, it didn't really make a huge difference whether you use fusion with just traditional bone grafting, you use fusion with screws, you use fusion with cages, and a certain percentage of these people didn't even have fusions, the outcome still seemed reasonable. So to me, it's a little bit different than what's conventional and what we're taught as residents. To me, I do think that less is better in certain situations. If you have limited spinal stenosis at one or two levels, I think you should try to limit the surgery to those levels. Mm-hmm. I do think less use of hardware is actually better for patients. But if you have a gross instability where things are moving very, very significantly, then at that point, I do think it makes sense to use some hardware to try to hold things together. From my standpoint, I don't think this changed how I do my practice. I try to treat people and try to get them better without surgery. A lot of times counseling and being realistic about outcomes, a lot of times people are okay with that and they accept non-surgical care. But people who are really severely painful, severe leg pain, they can't tolerate it anymore. I do think surgical decompression of the nerve roots makes sense. And if there is some degree of slippage, and especially if there's instability, you would also fuse at the same time.
So you did mention there that you're kind of in favor of using minimal amount of hardware. Going back to the different fusion groups here for a minute, you had a 360-degree fusion, which is inner body fusion with screws versus a fusion with just pedicle screws. How do you differentiate what patient would get one versus the other so the viewers understand?
Well, we talked about it already. If you have gross instability, you bend forward and you see the bone slipping forward significantly, you bend backwards, the bone slip back into place, then you know you have a much more unstable situation. In that situation, it probably would be better to support it by putting in screws, plates, and some sort of interbody device to prevent all that excess movement. Mm-hmm. The vast majority of people with degenerative spondylolisthesis does not have that kind of instability. The reason we do a fusion in those patients, in my mind, is we develop a potential for instability by doing the decompression. So we want to prevent that severe instability from developing. That's why we offer fusion. That's why just posterior lateral fusion with just bone graft, local bone graft, stiffen and harden that level so it doesn't move abnormally, probably works just as well as almost any of the other techniques. Now again, this is the not very unstable group of patients. Now if you're grossly unstable, yeah, you probably need to have everything done.
Okay. I think this was, a good topic, a very difficult paper kind of here to pull some conclusions out of, but some useful information kind of going forward here. I'd like to see the results of further studies to see some of the newer studies with newer data from, again, this data is now almost 15 years old, to see, do these results really hold up?
Well, one of the challenges of studies like this is we're talking about an older population. Who develops degenerative spondylolisthesis with spinal stenosis? They tend to be the older population. The older population, they're sicker. They have higher incidence of osteoporosis. They have other medical comorbidities. So a lot of times they would not be the perfect surgical candidate to any degree. But the level of pain causes them to desire to have surgery. I think doctors, we all try to do our best. I think clinical researchers try to do the best. But in the end, we're still dealing with human beings. So we can't have that perfect laboratory situation. We may never really know, but I am at least glad that the trending information is there is an advantage for surgery over non-surgical treatment for specific patients with this problem. Yeah. This is Dr. John Shim talking with Jason Mazza about spondylolisthesis and spinal stenosis and surgical treatment versus non-surgical treatment. I hope you found this interesting. Take care now.